Hey buds. When we last left our bees, they were happily gathering pollen and hatching brood, and life was great. And then, well, you know, life happened and there were a few twists and turns. So if you want to learn more about that, keep watching to see where we went wrong, what lessons we learned, whether we got any honey, and how the flow hives worked. Plus, you can watch us render the last of our beeswax. So we shall do a quick recap.
We wanted to have two hives, but because of last year's losses, we could only get one nuke to start with.
But things were going great.
Yay!
Then we started seeing supersedure and swarm cells. A supersedure queen cell is a big cell that looks a bit like a peanut located in the upper part of the frame. This means that the hive may have lost their queen, or they think that something is wrong with their current queen, so they are trying to make a new one. Swarm cells are the same kind of peanut-shaped queen cells, but they are located at the bottom of the frame. These indicate that the hive wants to split into two, possibly because they are feeling cramped. If left alone, the current queen leaves with half the hive, and the queen cells left behind will hatch and fight to the death to determine the new queen. This all gets a bit complicated, but usually you don't want your hive to swarm, and you may remove the queen cells to try and prevent it.
After a lot of fuss, our hive swarmed, while we were away for a few days. Normally you might be able to locate and catch a swarm, but we never found ours.
So we went on a grand adventure and purchased a new queen.
Yay!
But we thought they might have killed her.
Then we found eggs.
Yay!
But they were all drone eggs, meaning all boys and no worker bees, which would doom the hive.
Then all of a sudden, worker eggs started showing up.
Yay!
But our bees looked sick. Now they had varroa mites.
So we gave them medicine and they started looking better.
But how did the flow hives work? The flow hive is what inspired us many years ago to entertain the idea of beekeeping. We just thought it looked like such a neat system, and it is. However, we found it was difficult to get much support or advice for working with the flow hive in the prairies. It was developed in Australia, so you do need to adjust for the differences in location, and most beekeepers here are focused on commercial methods that maximize honey production rather than a hobbyist mindset. Normally, local beekeepers keep adding boxes, known as supers, as the bees produce more honey, and in Saskatchewan, our bees produce a lot. Stacking 8 to 10 boxes high is not uncommon. It's a good method and makes sense for commercial keepers, but full boxes can weigh over 100 pounds. Expensive equipment is required to extract the honey. The honey is all mixed together, and it may be disruptive to the bees. The flow hive helps with these problems for more upfront cost, but you can't take the honey out too early or it will spoil, so you must find a balance. Because of our troubles, we were not going at full strength, and we will have to learn how to accommodate our bees going forward. One lesson we learned along the way was the 7-10 rule. When 7 of the 10 frames in the box are filled by the bees, it's time to give them more space. What about honey? The honey did flow. We were super excited to harvest it. Normally, you would harvest outdoors with the flow, but this plot twist did allow us to have a bit more control, and we didn't have to fight off the wasps. The honey was different colors depending on which section it came from. Most of the honey stored in the flow super was lighter in color. We would guess that it was mostly gathered from canola crops, but as we were warned that canola is prone to crystallizing, we were very happy that there was no issue there. Fun fact! Honey is not the only thing the bees give us. Propolis is essentially bee glue that they make out of tree resins. The bees use it to repair and seal throughout the hive. But because of its antiviral, antimicrobial, and antioxidant properties, humans have found it to be useful as medicine. We have plans to experiment with it, so let us know if you'd be interested in learning more. And of course, there's also beeswax, which pound for pound is actually worth more than the honey. The trick is to separate the beeswax from everything else, which we were attempting to do in this old crock pot. If you melt it in water and then cool it, the beeswax comes to the surface and hardens. Isn't it a lovely golden color? And it smells so nice. But we'd like to try and get a few more impurities out, so we are going to melt it down inside this pantyhose. Now we have remelted our beeswax and we are going to pour it into these cute silicone molds. So now we have our bees all tucked in with several layers of wool insulation to help them stay warm. And we are just going to have to wait until spring to see how they make out and what the next chapter of our beekeeping adventures look like. One of the biggest threats to them actually is the varroa mites that were making them sick earlier. And the treatments for the mites are getting less and less effective. So it is a dire situation that's affecting many beekeeping apiaries. But there are a lot of great minds working on the problem. So there is hope. And one of the angles that we think is quite interesting is Paul Stemmett's research on using polypore mushrooms as a way to combat the mites. So if you're interested in keeping bees on the prairie, we would recommend this book, Beekeeping in Western Canada, as well as we found Beekeeping for Dummies had some good content. And you should definitely pay attention to what beekeepers in your area are doing. So you may be able to join a local group or chapter or even an online group that is specific to your area, and that will help you quite a bit. So if you have any questions, comments, or suggestions for us and our bees, please let us know in the comments. Till next time.
I did.